Hello, friends. Welcome back to the Boomerist Car Channel on all of YouTube. A lot of people have been asking, where do we get our motors done? Well, I wanted to finally show you where we get our motors rebuilt. This is Beckler Machine Shop, and this is Willie Beckler, good friend of ours. And I'll show you some pictures around the shop in a montage a little bit later. But for right now, we actually have a purpose for being here today. It's not just a social visit, although it's fun to visit with Willie. But we're putting together a Model A motor. This is the motor that goes in to Casey's car, the one that's, a 28 or 9, I forget what it is, special coupe that kind of got abandoned, and she's trying to put it back together. It was her dad's car. Everybody in the club's just chipping in. Willie has done amazing work, and I just want you guys to know, Willie is a really nice guy. He's not even charged me for this. So... But anyway, Beckler Machine Shop, I'll put the address on the screen right here in San Andreas, California. There really is a San Andreas. It's not just a Grand Theft Auto location.
Or a fault,
yeah. So anyway, we're going to get started on this motor. Willie's going to tell us, although you've got most of it put together. I see three pistons in already. You've been busy this morning.
I have.
But we got to put the fourth one in. We're going to fit the wrist pin to the piston. We're going to put the rings on it. We're going to put it in the block, and you get to see how all that happens.
Okay, first step of putting the connecting rod and the piston into the engine block is we have oversized wrist pins for the piston and the connecting rod. And this machine here hones out the piston and the connecting rod to fit the wrist pin. So I've already done the wrist pin and the connecting rod, so see how nice of a fit that is. Now we're gonna do the piston. So we start the machine up. Don't want to step on your cord here. We'll put the piston over the mandrel like that. It's got a little bit of oil. Take a little bit. Hone it back and forth a little bit. We'll check our size. Okay, nice fit, thumb fit, thumb press meaning, goes in tight with the thumb, and here's your comparator, tells you where we are. We're about 3/10 over, perfect. Okay, now we'll turn that off, we're done with that. We'll put this thing together. We got the clips. Here's the little clips right here that hold the wrist pin in place. Here's a little special little pair of pliers.
Oh yeah.
That I made when I was like 19 years old. I cut the little slots out so it would hold the circlip, so it won't go flying all over the shop. Which they have. I've had them hit me in the head.
Oh yeah.
Always wear safety glasses when you put...
These things are amazingly aerodynamic. They really are.
Yeah, make sure you wear safety glasses. We'll put a little bit of oil in here. Wrist pin. Put a little bit of oil on the wrist pin.
No grease.
Do not use grease. Do not use white grease. Do not use... chassis grease, do not use any grease.
No way.
Use oil if you can. And areas where, like in the rod and mains, you want to use a heavy duty oil. You could use, Lucas makes a heavy duty oil stabilizer. Mm-hmm. And that, because this engine is going to be sitting for a while, and it's going to be turning over. They're going to be turning it over while they're putting the valves and stuff in. So if you have a lightweight oil in here, It's going to dissipate.
Spit it out. Scrape, and you don't want that.
You got to have oil.
We use that, Hyper Lube, I think it's called.
Uh-huh.
That real thick oil. It's thicker than that 600W stuff.
Well, 600W, that's a gearbox oil.
It's thicker than that, but I'll put a link in the description below.
There you go. Okay, then we'll take our little pliers and hold on to that sucker.
Yeah, because it's going to go. I don't have safety glasses on. Like
if we can get it to go in.
It never does when the camera's rolling.
Right? Come on. Okay. Then I got a special little tool here. Push down on the wrist pin. You want to hear that sound, that click sound, then you know that the circlip is in its slot. And we'll put the other one in here like this. Come on.
If I turn the camera off, it'll go straight in.
Right?
Yeah.
There we go. So if you look in there, you'll see the clip is in there nice.
Perfect.
And you want to make sure that that clip is in there, because if the clip's not in there, it's going to come out, the wrist pin's going to come out, and it's going to score the cylinder wall. Within about 500 miles, you're going to have a oil burner.
Yep.
And a pissed off customer, even though it is free. So I always mark the rod, which way I'm going to put it in the engine block. So I put a couple of white marks here so that I know that as this engine, as I put the rod in, the dipper is going in the right spot to pick up oil. If you have it backwards, it'll starve oil and ruin your engine. So you always want to make sure that that dipper goes in the direction of the crankshaft so it can dip. Because this is all dip system. It's no oil pressure to the rods. There's a little oil pressure to the mains, but none to the rods. So I mark them, then I know the cap is going on the same place as the rod, because these are going to come apart. Shims are going to come off. Put the shims back in the exact same spot that you had it. So that's that step. Next step is the piston rings. Let's see, how do we want to do this?
Thank goodness you had a box of rings sitting on the shelf.
I did.
They were the right size, what are the odds?
Right? The odds aren't very good, are they?
No. See, the secret to success isn't being knowledgeable on everything, but knowing people who are. That's the secret.
So here's our rings. And we always check the ring end gaps, meaning this gap right here.
Yeah, you want to make sure that gap is not huge. It's got to be just about touching.
Yep. The basic rule of thumb is 3/1000ths end gap per inch of bore. So if you've got a 4-inch bore, which this is almost 4 inches.
So that'd be 12.
So that'd be 12/1000ths. That's minimum.
Minimum, okay.
Okay, so then you put your feeler gauge in between here.
I use this right here.
Yeah, or your finger, or your eyeball. Depends on how many times you've done this. So that's about 12. It's actually a little more. This thing's got 10/1000ths taper. So the hole is 10/1000ths bigger here than it is at the bottom. It really should be bored out, but 12/1000ths is maximum allowed by the ring manufacturers, because the taper is like this in the cylinder. So when the ring is up in the top, the gap is wide, and then when it's at, it's narrow, so it's doing this all the time, getting open and smaller and up and down, up and down. So that ring is really working.
That's how you get cracked rings.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So we'll check that one. It's relatively okay.
You're going to freak out how I do this. My pinky fingernail is exactly 12/1000ths. I know that sounds stupid, but that's how I do it. This is why you
shade tree mechanic. Yeah. You came from what town? Mountain Ranch? Yeah,
right. Yeah. West Point.
So you always want to check every ring. I've done enough of this to see rings misboxed.
Yeah, and they're the same box, and they'll be different sizes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Back in the early days, in the 70s, when we were building lots and lots and lots of engines, you had no idea what you were getting, so you had to check everything. Yeah. So.
It seems how most of our parts come off of shelves where they've been sitting for 50 years. We have to check them too.
You're right. Mm-hmm. Even though you did mark them.
Doesn't matter.
Okay.
Still check them every time.
So now we're going to put the pistons rings on the pistons, and I usually use a vise. Just hold it kind of lightly there. Get my special ring tool. So you put your rings on the tool like this, and it expands them. You can try to turn them on there, but a lot what happens is they'll break.
Yeah, yeah.
See, and cast iron doesn't like any pressure on it.
They don't like twists.
No. Molly rings and that kind of stuff, you can twist those things almost in half. They'll still retain their original form. But cast iron, forget it. And I've actually seen where I've put piston rings on the piston, and there'll be an air pocket from when they cast it, and right when you open it up, it snaps. So that's the, this is the first part of the ring. Then we got our little scrapers. I usually put one there, like that. And then I'll come around this other side.
You want the gap to be on the opposite side.
Yeah. And then split the rails from the center, one on each side. You can do both on the, do one on each side. I've seen them where they've put them on both the same side, but nah. And then there's a second ring and there's a first ring.
How do you tell?
Okay. On this ring here, got a little dot right there. Right there's a dot.
Just see it, yep.
And then if you see the dot on the bottom, on top, and you see the inside bevel opposite side, this is the second ring. So it goes in just like that. And then the first ring, they don't do it anymore. Now they're just straight cut. There's no bevel on the inside. There's no dot, so that ring can go either way. It does not matter.
That's your top ring.
But that's your top ring, yeah. And if you're doing Molly rings, you'll tell the top ring, it'll be nice and shiny, like chrome looking. And a little gray on the inside, that's a Molly ring. I don't recommend Molly rings on the Model A's. I guess if you're building a 8-to-1 compression engine, yeah, or 9 or something, yeah.
If you're doing a hill climb motor.
Yeah, you would probably want something a little bit better, maybe some chrome rings or something. But these things work great. But you have to hone the cylinder. You have to deglaze the cylinder, and I use this thing right here to deglaze the cylinder. It's they come in different grits. And I usually use the finer grit, like 220 or something.
You know you want to do this. Everybody, you know you want to.
Yeah, you want to touch that?
Yeah.
Yeah. So, and then that goes in a hole. Put a little bit of oil on it, cutting oil, and do your pattern. So, that's that. That was done first. There we go. I'm around there.
You brought the wireless.
So now we'll put the top ring, the second ring next. Put that in there like that. And you want to just get it so it just goes over. If you expand them too far.
Yeah, you don't want to stretch it.
You don't want to break them. Yeah, you don't want to break them at all. They will break.
Oh, yeah.
Cast iron. Okay, and this one can go in either direction like we talked. that. Okay, so now we'll put our tools away. Now we're going to take our rod cap off, and I got these kind of loose.
This is the same size nut on both sides of these.
Right.
Some of the garbage we work with. Make sure, do not lose the shims. Remember exactly where they go. Put them exactly back where they were.
So what I do is...
Otherwise you make multiple trips to the machine shop.
Right? So what I'll do is, I've got my white numbers here. Okay? And I've got this number going... this mark going to this mark. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to take it apart. I think I'm going to take it apart. Yeah. There we go. Come on.
If the camera was off, it would just fall it off.
You know how precision these Model A's are. So that was a little snugger.
A little bit.
Okay, so that shim's going to go there, and this shim's going to go there. Okay.
That's what the old man and I do. We call it upstream and downstream, looking at the dipper.
Oh, okay. And you always want to protect your bolt, because what happens is you get to...
Booger those threads up.
You booger up the crankshaft, put a little nick in there, and it'll take the babbit and wipe that babbit out. Not all the whole thing, but it'll just take and put a line in there like that. So we always protect our rods.
You brought protection.
I did. I always do. But they're used. they're not brand new. Okay.
Sorry, children.
So next thing we'll do is
not made for kids now.
Yeah, right. So we put a little oil on the cylinder wall. Always oil everything up. Wrist pins, rings, we'll oil everything.
You're moving it around when you're putting the valves in, and when you're adjusting the valves, this thing's going to get a lot of movement.
So, my what?
A squeezy. Oh, there it is.
I'm going to do that.
Or is that your thermos? That's a sleeve.
That's a sleeve. What are you looking for?
A squeezy.
Oh, they're right here. Okay, yeah, now
fancy one.
We want to put a little bit of that's oil. Yeah, you like that one?
I like that one. Yeah. That's better than ours.
What do you got?
The Harbor Freight kind with the Titan. The
oh, yeah.
Yeah.
So put a little assembly lube. I'll show you the real slick ones.
That's not the slick one?
No.
Oh.
That's not the slick one. Okay, so now we're going to put a little bit of lubrication on here. Okay. All right. Got this rag. Just put that back over there. Clean off my finger. And then I put a little bit of oil on here to help out. There. Yep. Okay. Now, we'll take the piston and put the rings in the right location. So I have the oil ring with the separation there and a separation there. Now I'm going to go over here with this top ring and second ring and put them like that. So your gaps are offset. So they're not lined up. And then we know that this part of the rod is up. So we're going to put this in here like that. Oh, wrong hole. Wrong hole.
Wrong hole.
How can you tell? Oh, there was something in it?
There was, yeah.
Okay, so this is one form of ring compressor.
That's a nice one.
Which works pretty good. And then, let me get this other one. These are the slick ones.
Look at that. It's anodized and everything.
Yeah, and the purpose for these is you just have to put the piston through here, and it's tapered. It's got a little taper to it. So as you push the piston in, it shrinks, it pulls in the rings to the right size, and then you can pop it in there.
I'm in lust.
And if you're building a stroker motor, you have to use this type of a compressor. You cannot get away with one of these or the old school one. There's another old school one right there. Let me show you another old school one.
Oh yeah, I remember those.
There's this type here. I hardly ever use this type, but sometimes you can't help it, you gotta. But
ours looks like that one.
Like this one?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's cool. That's we used to use those all the time. But these are the best.
Oh yeah, that's cool.
That thing is just, you just pop it in there and hit it once and it's in. Okay, so now I have my assistant here holding the can I have that red hammer right there? Yeah. So some guys use wooden hammers, the handle of the wooden hammers to drive them in, or a wooden stick.
Bad.
So we're going to put the rings on like that, the compressor on like that, I mean.
Yep.
And then we'll give it a couple of hits. And she goes. Let me tell you, most of the time, more than not, it's not that easy. Especially if you're putting stroker kits together or any of this high performance stuff, they usually don't go in that easy. Unless you use this type of compressor, man, then they go in nice and easy. Okay, ready?
Yep. Almost there. Slow down. There.
We're in.
Done.
Okay, then now we'll turn this thing around. Pull our pieces off, our little booties. And
our shims and our cap.
Yeah, we got our cap marked with a dot, white marker up. So when you're turning the engine over like this, which is clockwise,
that dipper is picking up oil.
The dipper is here. It's digging down into the oil and coming back up.
Right.
So we have that on correct. And this one and this one and this one. We know that for a fact.
Well, it's correct after it has shims.
Right. And then this shim goes here. And this shim goes down here. We'll just put that baby together like that. Okay, and we got our nuts. Yeah, we got two nuts here. Okay. I got her. Okay. And then we'll tighten her up.
Well, my dad and I, we proved that you can be nuts and boobs at the same time. Sorry, children.
Okay, tighten that bad boy up. And these have cotter pins in them, so they have holes. So you're gonna have to line up the cotter pin holes when you torque it up. So we're just gonna go over here. We're gonna do this the right way, torque it up a little bit.
I usually end up with the torque with the hole exactly in the middle of one of the crowns.
Oh, yeah. So what do we torque these things up at?
I think you can as much as you want. I go 35.
Do you?
Yeah.
Okay, we're going to...
Is that right or wrong? You're the machinist.
Well, we're going to go there. We can go 40. We'll go in between. How's that?
I leave myself some headroom because I got to find the cotter hole.
Right?
Yeah. Which is usually wrong anyway.
All right.
I jinxed it.
There you go. Did you hear the click? That's the sound that we need. And we know we're at torque. So this, we'll set this thing up at between 35 and 40 pounds. Okay. We got to make sure we got clearance here.
Yeah, make sure it's not and over tight.
One of the things you want to always look at when you're putting the rod in, because sometimes they come bent, is you look down into the wrist pin hole and you make sure that you see daylight on both sides of the piston for the connecting rods, and you can see the wrist pin in there. Then you know that you're pretty well centered and the rod doesn't have a like a dog leg or something in it.
I already apologize for that.
For your dog leg?
For that rod.
Oh, that rod.
Yeah.
So now we got our little turner over tool. Let's see if this thing turns over. Oh, yeah, look at that. Even with the wrench, it turns
fancy.
Over. And how's it look for the top?
Your top dead center right here. Looks like about 20,000 sticking up.
On both of them?
Yeah. It's the same.
Yeah.
Wow.
If you really want to get fancy, you can put a dial indicator on this side of the head and check to see how far the piston comes out of the hole, because if you get a cylinder head that has been machined the recess out of it, mm-hmm. and then you get a thin head gasket or a normal size head gasket, and if the piston's sticking out too far, it's going to hit the cylinder head.
Don't you just stack head gaskets?
Yeah, you want to get those head gaskets?
All those graphite ones?
Graphite ones, and stack them.
Never. Don't do that.
No, copper head gaskets are the only way to go.
Yes.
Trust us on this. We've been around the horn on this one. So, yes. Well, that's it for this lesson.
Great.
Do you have any other questions?
Yes. What makes the Teflon stick to the pan?
What makes the Teflon stick to the pan? That's a good question.
Well, there you go. All right. That's it. That's all I got. Thanks, Willie. All right.
You're welcome.
This motor's destined to go back into a special coupe.
Yes, all the pistons and rods are in. Now that you get to do the valve work.
Yay! My favorite job.
And clean it up a little bit. It looks...
I know.
It looks pathetic.
So there we go. We have one Model A engine block ready. All I got to do is take it back to our shop now. We're going to put the valves in it, put it back together, put it back in the car. I'll get to show you what that looks like. Willie, thank you so much for everything.
Oh,
seriously.
You're very welcome. Yeah,
you
got to
check out Beckler Machine Shop in San Andreas, and I got you a present.
Aw.
Ta-da. I hope it fits. Dang. Oh, yes.
Hey, fits perfect.
Good enough. See? Use the warranty now. Beckler Machine Shop, San Andreas. That's where we get our motors done. Check it out. I'll put the phone number down too. Then just your phone will ring off the hook.
Trust me. Yeah. Well,
thanks so much for watching. We'll catch you on the next video.
Thank you.